Let me illustrate this again. For any sample, you know how to compute a confidence interval. If your null hypothesis is inside the confidence interval of the observed sample, everything is okay, and you believe the null hypothesis. Conversely, if your null hypothesis falls outside, you don't believe the null hypothesis, and you accept the alternate hypothesis. So simple is hypothesis testing, and you use confidence intervals instead of, for example, the binomial distribution. And that's really the common case. So let me just briefly summarize what you're doing. Given the sample or data, you compute the mean, you compute the variance, you get the t-value at some desired error probability p, and you have to make sure you pick the correct one. If it's one-sided, you pick a different one from the two-sided. And then the plus-minus term in the confidence interval is simply this number over here times the square root of the empirical variance over n. That algorithm would have looked really cryptic if I had just given it to you. But by now it should make a lot of sense because we've practiced every element of it. The mean, the empirical variance, getting a number from a table, and then compute the size of the confidence interval, which you then put into the plus minus term. So mu minus this is the lower bound, mu plus this is the upper bound of the confidence interval according to the confidence level specified by the error probability p. So let's put this into action. A dance club operator advertises the fact that the average age of its client is 26. You walk in and encounter the following people. Four people are 21. Six people are 24. Seven people are 26. 11 people are 29. And two people are actually 40 years old, for a total of n equal 30 people. Now, compute for me whether you now trust the statement that the average age is 26. And let's do so. Obviously, the fact that there's two 40-year-olds is a little bit disturbing. So let's do so in stages. I'm going to guide you through this. First, let's calculate the mean.